Welcome to Agenda Alexandria. I'm the chair of Agenda, Russ Bailey, and it's my pleasure to welcome you here this evening. Agenda's very lucky to have a terrific group of sponsors this year, and so the very first thing I'd like to do this evening is acknowledge them. Alexandria Chamber of Commerce, Ann Ewan of State Farm Insurance, Barbara Anderson of the Life and Estate Planning Law Center, and David Speck of Speck Caudron, Frank Fannin, who's here this evening, of SunTrust, I think. Thank you, Frank. And Gant Redman of Redman, Payton, and Braswell, and Lee Gary of Sotheby International Realty, and Tobin and Donna James. I know Donna's here this evening, of Honest Air Heating and Air Conditioning. Thank you, Donna. Where are you, Donna? Okay, there you are. Okay. And Willem Pollock and Charlotte Hall of the Potomac Riverboat Company, and William Ewell. Tonight we also have with us Tim Lovain from City Council. Okay. And again, it's welcome back, Rodney Clark and Derek Limas in the back, who are covering for Channel 70. And they our programs are shown weekly on Mondays and Saturdays at 9 o'clock and on Wednesdays at 10 a.m. in the morning, the month following the program. Our members are very active in Alexandria, and they produce a lot of literature, and we're glad to have it. So if you would like us to display it at our tables outside, please see the woman to see in the back, that's Sherry Brown, or any of the board members who can be identified by the red borders on their tags. At the moment, I'd like the board members to stand up and be recognized, please. Thanks. And of course, I got to make a pitch. If you haven't joined Agenda Alexandria, it's never too late, or in this case, it's never too early, since we've gotten at that time of the year where we're going on the other side of the hill, so we'd be glad to have you. And I think there are membership applications on the table. Am I correct, Sherry? Okay, there are. And we have some very, very, I think you'll find, challenging and engaging topics coming up. Of course, we have a very good one tonight. Next month, we're gonna have a program on emergency preparedness, so you can learn about what the city does to prepare and what you can do to prepare if there's an emergency. And if there is not an emergency next month, we will have a couple emergency vehicles here that you can look at, including a little guy that apparently can go on the bike path in case there's an emergency up on the Wilson Bridge. And I was wondering, Alan, does it have a name like Herbie or something? Or so? So I think it may fit in the lobby. So it's going to be with us next month. Tonight's program is organized by Rosalind Bovey, Tim Ahern, and Bill Clayton, and it is focuses on people with mental illnesses in the justice system, treatment and reentry. And I want to remind you that while the speakers are speaking, on your table are little colored colored pieces of paper there. There they are. That's where you write your questions. We only take written questions. We don't take oral questions because we all like to get out of here on time. Please write them down, and at the end of the presentations, the board members will come around, collect your questions, and then we'll have the program chairs ask the questions of the speakers. And so now, Bill, Rosalind, and Tim, it's all yours. Thanks.
Thank you, Russ. People with mental illness and substance abuse disorders are greatly overrepresented in the criminal justice system compared to their prevalence in the general population. These individuals often cycle in and out of the criminal justice system, in large part because these systems are not designed to bridge the gap between mental health and criminal justice. Tonight's presentation will discuss what officials in Alexandria have done to address this problem in our city. Key programs and services have been developed over the past few years, which have proven highly successful. Many are based on nationally recognized models of how communities can combat this problem, and one program, known as CORE, was created right here in Alexandria and is recognized around the Commonwealth as a model approach for helping persons with mental illness live law-abiding and productive lives in the community. We're fortunate to have on tonight's panel the people who have helped Alexandria lead the way in making productive citizens of former inmates. A thumbnail sketch of their recent bios outlines their specific experience. Leading off tonight's panel is Liz Wixon, the Director of Clinical and Emergency Services at the Department of Community and Human Services. She oversees Alexandria's outpatient mental health and substance abuse programming, including psychiatry, jail services, emergency services, detox, opioid treatment, outpatient substance abuse, and mental health services. She also coordinates Alexandria's Criminal Justice and Behavioral Health Collaborative. Over the last few years, Ms. Wixon has helped spearhead Alexandria's efforts to divert persons with mental illness away from the criminal justice system, including the development of Alexandria's Crisis Intervention Team program and CORE, which stands for Collaboration for Recovery and Reentry. CORE is a partnership between the Alexandria CSB and the Office of Probation and Parole, and it's aimed at helping mentally ill offenders live healthy and law-abiding lives in the community. Ms. Wixon is a graduate of Providence College and received her Master's of Social Work from the University of Maryland. Next, Sergeant Courtney Ballantyne from the Alexandria Police Department. Sergeant Courtney Ballantyne is currently assigned to Daylight Patrol and supervises 8 patrol officers. He's been with the city since 2000 and was promoted to the rank of sergeant in 2007. Sergeant Ballantyne has previously been assigned to the record section of the police department and as the supervisor of the school resource officers. In 2008, Sergeant Ballantyne was assigned to lead the police department's implementation of the Crisis Intervention Team for Alexandria. Since then, the Alexandria CIT program has conducted 13 classes and trained over 200 first responders in crisis intervention. Sergeant Ballantyne participated in the International Association of Chiefs of Police 2009 summit with a briefing titled Building Safer Communities, Improving Police Response to Persons with Mental Illness Policy. Next, Bill Rooney is a supervisor of the Comprehensive Recovery Team and the CORE program at the Department of Community and Human Services. CRT includes adult mental health case management, CORE and mental health jail diversion, not guilty by reasons of insanity, state hospital discharge planning, and homeless outreach programs. Bill helps to implement the CORE and mental health jail diversion and the CIT programs. He has worked for the DCHS since 2006. And last but not least, Lisa Stapleton is employed with the Virginia Department of Corrections as the Chief Probation Officer for the City of Alexandria. She has worked for the Virginia Department of Corrections since 1992 and has been chief since 2007. 12 probation officers in the Alexandria office supervise over 500 adults who have been mostly convicted of felony offenses. Chief Stapleton assisted in the establishment of the CORE program and is a graduate of the CIT program. She's a member of Alexandria's Community Criminal Justice Board, Domestic Violence Intervention Project, Senior Policy Group on Gangs, and is the co-chair of the Alexandria Reentry Council. She's a 1985 graduate of American University, right in the neighborhood. Please welcome our panelists. Ms. Wixon will lead off the discussion.
I feel like this is higher than my whole body. I'm gonna move that down a little bit. Hi, everyone. Thank you, Tim, for that nice introduction, and thank you to Agenda Alexandria for inviting us to be with you tonight on what is a topic that we, my colleagues and I, and many people in the city feel very strongly about. Thank you also for all of you who came out to hear what we have to say. We're glad that you have an interest in it and hope to be part of a conversation with you this evening about what we're doing and where we hope to go in the future. All right, here we go. Oh, I blew it already. Just the left, right? Okay. Let me begin by sharing some data with you that I think does a nice job of framing the issue that we're going to be talking about. One in 31 adults in our country right now are involved in the criminal justice system. Let me say that again so you can really think that through. It's startling to me every time I say it. One in 31 adults are involved in the criminal justice system in our country. In just the last 20 years in Virginia, we've seen a 137% increase in the number of people in our correctional system, in our jails, in our prisons, on probation and parole. 293,000 Virginians are arrested annually. 31,500 of those are in prisons, and 26,669 are in jails. Of these, 6,300, or about 24%, have a mental illness. 75% of those persons have a co-occurring substance use problem. So that means they have both a mental illness and a substance use problem at the same time. Mentally ill inmates cost more to detain than other inmates. They spend 2 to 5 times longer in jail than persons without mental illness. They often cycle in and out of the correctional system, often becoming homeless and requiring more police intervention. We know that our jails serve as de facto psychiatric hospitals. Our jails and prisons house more people on any given day than do all of our state psychiatric hospitals combined. So what does this mean if you're someone who has a mental illness or a behavioral health disorder? The probability of being arrested is greater for suspects exhibiting symptoms of mental disorders than those who are not. Many individuals with mental illness have no source of funds and may be detained because they cannot post even very low bail and are not offered release on personal recognizance. Persons with mental illness will often be charged with more serious crimes than other people arrested for similar behavior. And people with mental illness are charged, convicted, and sentenced more severely than other people accused of similar crimes. Not only are these trends obviously bad for people who have a behavioral health disorder, but they're troublesome for people who work in the criminal justice system. This was a citywide problem that we knew required a citywide solution. About 5 years ago, a number of people in the city came together and said, enough is enough. There must be something that we can do differently in Alexandria to help change these patterns. The police department, the sheriff's office, the public defender's office, the Commonwealth's attorney, probation and parole, and our judges all started talking about what we needed to do differently in Alexandria to change what we were all seeing. I have to tell you, in talking with my counterparts around Virginia, I should have said, this is not a problem unique to Alexandria. It is not a problem unique to Virginia. This is happening in communities all over the country. In talking with my counterparts around Virginia, I realized we are very fortunate in Alexandria. 5 or 6 years ago, when we started realizing that this was an issue we wanted to address in Alexandria, every single player, every single agency that needed to be part of the solution wanted to be part of the solution. There was no arm twisting, there was no begging. Everybody was seeing the same trends from the clients that we serve, and everybody wanted to be a part of the solution. One thing we learned early on is that there was not going to be one solution to this problem. We were not going to hire one new staff person or implement one new program. We each needed to figure out what role we could play across the system. Another thing that we learned early on is that we already had a lot of key ingredients in place. We already had a community-based mental health and substance abuse service system that works very well. We already had a number of treatment staff working in the detention center. We already had staff in our public defender's office who were creating alternative sentencing plans. We had police officers who wanted to know more about how to recognize the signs and symptoms of mental illness and how to respond differently to people in crisis. And as I said, we had all the key players from the very beginning who wanted to be part of the solution. What we didn't have were good connections between all of us. Through no fault of any of ours, we realized that we had created some silos, a lot of silos. We were all doing very good jobs in our own little boxes, but those boxes created gaps, and our clients were falling in those gaps. And we needed to figure out a way to help them bridge those gaps. We needed to think differently. We needed to do differently to help people be more successful and live law-abiding lives in our community. So we came together as a community, all the partners that I mentioned earlier, and we defined two goals for ourselves early on. Number one, divert persons with serious mental illness away from arrest and into treatment. So that what that means is when we can prevent an arrest, let's try to do that. And number two, we know that that's not always possible. So when someone does get arrested, we want to prevent that. We want to prevent folks with serious mental illness from penetrating more deeply into the correctional system. You heard me say earlier, people with mental illness spend 2 to 5 times longer than people without mental illness in the correctional system. They cost more to incarcerate. So it's important that when we look at the continuum of services, that we figure out a way to help people from penetrating more deeply into it, because it's very hard to get out when you have a behavioral health disorder. Before I go further, I want to mention what I mean by the words jail diversion. You may hear me say those words tonight. You may hear my colleagues say that tonight. This is what we mean by the words jail diversion, diverting people away from arrest and helping them from penetrating more deeply into the system. What we do not mean is giving anyone a get-out-of-jail-free card because they're mentally ill. We do not mean risking public safety because someone has a mental illness. We're talking about examining our service system as a whole and figuring out how we can help persons with mental illness live law-abiding lives in our community. We're talking about improving public safety. Don't look at this too hard because it will give you a headache. This is the model that we chose to use as a community about 5 years ago. It's called the Sequential Intercept Model, and it's used around the country. And what it basically says, as defined by color, is that there are 5 intercepts. There are 5 opportunities for communities to come together, to think differently, to do differently with people who have mental illness. We have 5 points along the continuum. The first, represented over here on the left in the yellow, is law enforcement, community. What can we do when someone's in the community to help them from being arrested in the first place so that they don't enter the system? Moving to the right, intercept 2 is what we call initial detention, initial court hearings. Should someone get arrested and go to the detention center, within the first day or two, there is an opportunity for staff to identify that a behavioral health disorder may be present and to think about what information we may be able to share with judges at that time. Is there anything we can do to help the person leave the system before they dive too deeply into it? In pink are the jails and courts. Well, what do you do if somebody ends up in jail? Someone with a serious behavioral health disorder, what do you do? How do you recognize someone who needs treatment? What sorts of treatments might be effective? How do you help someone stabilize who may be in a crisis? Also in this intercept 3 are courts. These are things, these are specialty courts, things like drug courts you may have heard of, mental health courts. These are specialty dockets that have proven to be pretty successful around the country. Fourth is intercept 4, reentry. You're going to hear Lisa Stapleton talk about this in just a little bit. One of the things you'll hear her say is that most of the people who are in jail and prison right now, almost all of them, are coming back. They are coming back to their home communities. And we need to be very thoughtful about how we help them come back so that they can be successful. And intercept 5, over on the right in purple, this is community corrections, community support. So someone is now in the community. Either they've reentered, they've left jail, and they're now in the community, or they're in the community and they have not yet entered the criminal justice system. What do we do? How do we help them be successful in the community so that they don't either start over at the beginning or they don't enter in the first place? Our time tonight does not permit us to get into the many different programs and initiatives that we have throughout that model that I showed you. We are going to hear about CIT from Sergeant Courtney Ballantyne. Let me mention briefly detox drop-off, what this means. DCHS runs a detox program. It's across the street from the jail. Actually, it's not too far from where we are. And we have an arrangement with the Alexandria Police Department. When they pick someone up in the community who appears to be drunk in public, there isn't another charge, but the person appears intoxicated, they bring the person to detox. They offer that person an opportunity to get treatment for the very thing that brought them to the attention of the police in the first place, as opposed to taking them to jail and entering the criminal justice system, which, as you heard me say, we don't want, because people get stuck there, they stay longer. Number 3, jail-based treatment. We have right now at the Alexandria Detention Center a team of mental health and substance use staff who treat about 1/3 of the inmates that we have in our detention center. We are very fortunate to have the support of Sheriff Lawhorn, who has been not only a tremendous advocate of behavioral health services, but frankly, of all opportunities for inmates to learn skills, to get education, to really change their lives, so that, when they come back to our community, they are in better shape than when they left. Next, sentencing alternatives. Melinda Douglas and the folks over at the Public Defender's Office run a really neat service. They create something called sentencing alternative plans. These are treatment plans, really, that her staff present to judges as something for a judge to consider when he or she is sentencing someone. So the judge can consider sending someone to jail, putting someone on probation or parole, or perhaps sending them to a residential treatment program where they can address the very symptoms that often brought them into the criminal justice system to begin with. Reentry, you're going to hear from Lisa Stapleton, and court, you're going to hear from Bill Rooney. I'd like to turn things over now to Sergeant Courtney Ballantyne from the Police Department. Sergeant Ballantyne, along with John Twamer from DCHS, started our CIT program about 4 years ago and grew it from just a little kernel of a dream to what we thought was possible to really being one of the most robust and successful programs in all of Virginia.
I have the opposite problem. I don't want to have to hold this. Can everybody hear me in the back? Great, that's fantastic. All right, so I'm up here to talk to you about the Alexandria Crisis Intervention Team, like Liz just said. And I want to first thank you all for the opportunity to be here. This program that I'm getting ready to talk about is personally just been a growth opportunity for me to help create something for the city of Alexandria and for the citizens. So let me put that over here. I apologize. So what is the Crisis Intervention Team program? Like Liz was saying just a minute ago, it's a pre-booking jail diversion program. And if I lose track of the microphone, I'll lose the voice. For the folks with mental illness, and that's really important to understand the difference. Liz mentioned about the detox program, which we've used for years as officers to divert folks from the jail that have a substance abuse problem to this program over on Mill Road. Well, this is very similar to that, and that's a really big selling point to the police department. Because I'll talk about it in a minute, but it frees up time the officers are on these calls for service, which is a big deal in my work. It's a process for addressing system change for crisis care within the community. Again, Liz mentioned a while ago, it brought all the right people to the table to talk about what we're all responding to. And this was a nice table to be at because it wasn't the chiefs of police, it wasn't the sheriff, it was the people like myself and Liz and John and Bill that actually do the work and respond out onto the street. And we were very candid about what we were dealing with, and we were able to make change and decisions on how, as a group, we would help folks with mental illness. And that's really important to understand. This program was designed for the officers, the social workers, and the paramedics and the deputies that are actually out on the street and responding to these calls. It's about the responsibility to the community, consumers, and their family members. We, as law enforcement and other public safety, can't do this on our own. We can't continually respond and keep folks out of the criminal justice system without the help of the family, without the help of them, the consumer saying, I want help, and really important, the community itself. We all have to work together, and really this program help the officers to realize there's other resources within the community, in the house itself, the family members. They're in this crisis as much as the folks that we're responding to. So we're looking at things differently and trying to use all the resources to help make change. And this is my favorite saying, it's more than a training program for public safety, it's a mindset change. And one of the big questions we always ask in our classes, where would you want your loved one to get help? Would you want your loved one to get help at home or in jail or at a hospital? And that's the first time officers have really ever been asked that. We always talk about in the academy, treat like you would want your wife to be treated, your husband to be treated when we go on these calls, but we often forget about that pretty quickly. 5 years into our career, we get jaded, and that's honestly, we do. And that's something that we really try to talk about in this class to bring the officers back to the basics and understand that we're helping people. And there's no difference except the environment and the circumstances between us and the folks that we're helping. So the crisis intervention team, we didn't invent this, and we certainly are not going to take credit of inventing this wheel. This was developed in Memphis, Tennessee in 1988, and we brought it to the city in 2008. So it's really a good program, and it's something that's been thought out, it's been worked, and it's been proven successful in so many different places. But as you can imagine, this program was probably developed because something terrible happened. And that's exactly what happened. In 1988 in Memphis, a consumer was shot by the police. But this gentleman was holding a knife, threatening the officers. It was justified at the time, and it probably would be justified today. But what came out of that is a lot of the what if questions. What if the officer had asked us this question? What if the calls before that we brought to the table when they responded this time? And that's really what started this whole CIT program, and that's what's causing us to be so successful. We're asking the what if questions before it happens. And like I said, it's been extensively studied by the police researchers and has been proven effective and replicated in dozens of metropolitan areas nationwide and internationally. I get the pleasure of going to a conference once a year, and every year it gets bigger and bigger, and now we're international. Australia is coming to this conference, and you sit there and you think this was all started because people got onto a table and asked the right questions, and it's such a successful program. So again, CIT, this is why we're here. And this is why the chiefs of police and the sheriff and the fire chief said, I'll do this, I'll support this, because it reduces injuries to us, the people that are going to help folks, but really also just as important, it reduces injuries to them. And that's why we're all up here saying this is a great program, because we don't want to hurt anybody, and we certainly don't want to get hurt. So anything that we can do, training or anything, we're going to do it to be successful and reduce the amount of injuries. And like I said at the beginning, this reduces the time that police and EMS are spend on mental health related calls for service. And anytime we can do that, that's a great thing, because as you guys can imagine, we're constantly going call to call to call. Going back to that first point, it also reduces use of forces. Use of force is when an officer uses some sort of non-lethal or lethal force to effect an arrest. And this has drastically reduced our numbers in the police department, and it's also been proven nationwide that it does work. And that's another success, and that's why we're up here. And then the final one, and the most obvious, it keeps many persons with mental illness out of the criminal justice system. It goes back to that first question we asked the students: where would you want your loved one to get treatment, in the jail or in the community or at home? I wouldn't stare at this either. Yeah, it'll make you dizzy. I can't even read my notes, but I've done this enough. So Monday, I mean, it's a week-long program. It's 40 hours, and if you ask a police officer, what is your biggest fear? It's a 40-hour week-long training, because they're so, you know, we like to work shift work, 12 hours. We're on and we're off, we're on. Well, this is a Monday through Friday, and this will ruin their day. So we really get into the nuts and the bolts pretty quickly on the Monday, and it's all about lecture. So unfortunately, it's a lot of lecture, but it's really important to lay the groundwork for a successful training on that first day. So the Monday, we talk about why we're here. You saw a lot of the slides that I show. It's jail diversion program. It's more than a training. It's a mindset. And we talk about that. We talk about stigma, because that's a huge problem with mental illness, stigma. So we try to take that right off the table and start thinking of it differently. My friend John will talk about the different types of mental illness, because if you're responding to help somebody, you have to know what you're responding to help them. Like, you need to know what's going on. We don't assume anything. And we do a hearing voices exercise. We put officers it's an iPod, and it's called hearing voices, and it will mimic schizophrenia, hearing voices. And then we have them do tasks, very simple things, going to talk to a doctor, doing a written comprehensive exam, very simple. And then just simply having conversations, going to a store. We found they can't do it. is so distracting. And it's such an eye-opening experience for them because they realize, I'm responding to help people with this. Now I know why they're not responding to me. Their not responding is not them being non-compliant. As, you know, when you don't understand something, we get louder. You probably have seen cops. So it's, we want them to just take a minute and just think, repeat yourself, maybe three times. Let them process what you're asking them, and that's really important. And then we talk about cultural diversity, because many different cultures in the city of Alexandria, as you all know, everybody has a different view about mental illness, and it's really important as law enforcement and public safety that we think about that when we step into somebody's house. We have to understand where they're coming from and adapt a little bit to their cultural, be culturally sensitive. And finally, this is still day one. We also bring in family and actual consumers to the class that are not in crisis. This is a first time for a lot of these officers to talk to somebody with a mental illness they're not responding to. And that's really important to have them understand that they're just like us. There's no difference. We're all human, and that's really important. And I'll speed up. I'm probably going to get through the time. Tuesday we do tours, because quite often the officers don't know the resources that are right in front of them. They don't necessarily know where they can send somebody. So actually we get in vans and we drive around on Tuesday, and we actually go to these different places and talk about the services that are offered there. Because as an officer going out on a call for service, to be able to explain to somebody what's going to happen is huge, because it's that question mark, it's the unknown that oftentimes drives us to have to be forceful, unfortunately. So if we have an opportunity to stop that by simply explaining things better and knowing more, that's what Tuesday is all about. On Wednesday, we get into actual legal issues. We have the Commonwealth Attorney's Office come in, talk about some of the very confusing legal jargon that they are so good at. But we really let the officers ask questions, because, you know, as much, this is not one of those calls for service that an officer wants to go on, because it's unknown. And that's unfortunate, because it shouldn't be that way. It should be an opportunity to help somebody. And that's what we talk about, the legal parts. Wednesday and Thursday and Friday, it all changes gears. We do role playing, and just like everybody nobody likes to role play, but it's such an important part of our training program, because it reinforces things that we talk about during the day by doing different scenario-based role playing. On Wednesday, we start off with a basic role play. Everybody has to do it. My friend Lisa actually had to do it, and this was fantastic. But on Thursday, we get into just some very special population stuff, geriatric issues. We go into PTSD, which is out there all around us, as you all know, in the news. And then we practice these things, active listening skills, really to have the officer be comfortable with what we're talking about. And then on Friday, we actually bring judges in, lawyers, and we have a mock hearing so the officers know what's next. We're in the generations have quickly changed from the Generation X, Generation Y. Well, why is this? Why is that? That's what we're finding as officers. So we actually offer an opportunity for them to ask why and show them why there's a hearing, why and what's next. And that's really important to them to feel like the program, they need to get the most out of the program. Having a judge in a room is awesome. She takes an hour and a half and talks about her part of her role. And it's amazing. It's a very powerful presentation. We talk about homeless issues, which is real. I get the pleasure of talking about directives and data. It's great. And then again, we have the advanced role plays. And that really sums up the week. And that's all in just 5 days. It goes very quickly, and we get a lot of great feedback from it, to include 25-year veterans saying, this is the best training I ever had. Why did it take so long to get it? Those are very warming evaluations, but it's a great question. Why did it take so long to get it? But we try to get through it. Let's see if I messed this up. Okay. So this is just a synopsis of what we talked about, the site visits. We talked about that, the different places that we go to. Really important to talk about the homeless shelters, because so often we have this mindset of what a homeless shelter is, just a bunch of cots. Well, in fact, the Carpenter Shelter is such a well-run program It's an amazing program. We actually have officers go in there, see and what the services that are offered, and that in the picture, I mean, it's just a great program. I think I sold that. All right. So scenarios, hearing voices, the mock hearing, and active listening skills are all things that we talked about. We have the mental health experts come in. We have the folks that have mental illness come in, and former homeless folks come in, talk about their experiences with the police, good and bad, eye-opening experience for officers. And so going into the goals of the program, you're not misreading that 100%. That's a goal, to train all of our patrol officers. I can tell you right now we're about 44% in, which is fantastic. There's always a CIT officer out on the street at all times. And then the next one is 100% of our dispatchers. And that's a really important part, because as Liz showed you earlier with that other mind nausea looking thing, intercept one, the first point of entry into our system is our 911 center. And they're the person that they're that anybody talks to, and they're going to direct who's going to get what service. So if we give them the same information or as a lot of information that the officers are getting, they can quickly identify the problem and dispatch it better and more appropriate. So this is the numbers. And in my bio, it said, I think, 250. We're already up to 282 because this train has not stopped. The police department's had 113 officers go through it, 72 sheriff's deputies, because the sheriff's deputies are at the courthouse. They're out doing warrant service. They're running into and responding to calls. So often when the folks do go into the criminal justice system, there's always a court hearing. Well, guess where they go? The courthouse. So if we have the deputies at the courthouse trained in this program as well, we're able to help get them in the right place. State probation and parole, Alexandria Fire Department, because they're at the table at the beginning, and they're responding to calls for service involving the same people that we were responding to, and they're saying, well, let's all be, and this was a great opportunity to work with. We realized pretty quickly it's a great opportunity to work with not only the police department, the sheriffs, but the fire department, all public safety, the code enforcement, fire marshals, because we're all responding. We're always out on the street. The Department of Emergency Communications is the dispatchers, so we have those folks trained. And then other, it's a pretty broad number, 20 or broad name, 22, but we've trained other agencies, and we've also trained some secretarial support staff, even at City Hall, the code enforcement folks, because oftentimes people come in to make complaints that have a mental illness. They're able to identify that and send them in the right direction. And then finally, looking ahead, last year we received a grant from the Attorney General's office to enhance our current program. It's a little less than $50,000, which is a great opportunity for us to continue to make our program better and to continue training. And with that, I want to introduce Lisa Stapleton.
Good evening. First of all, I, like my counterparts, would like to thank you for allowing us to come and talk about something that is very near and dear to our hearts. And I'm here to talk to you about reentry. And this has been getting a little bit of notice in the news and whatnot lately.
Lisa.
Yes. Oh, do I have to? Thank you. I know. And what this is about, it's about bringing people back from jail and prison and maximizing their likelihood of success. Now, my presentation is going to be a little bit broader than just in the mental health arena, because in reentry we deal with everybody who's coming back from jail and prison, and not just those suffering from mental illness. But all the services that we offer our general clients are the same services that we offer for our clients with mental illness, and they have a lot of the same needs and require the same attention. So when I say reentry is not optional, it goes back to something that Liz said earlier. These folks are going to come out of jail, they're going to come out of prison, whether they're ready for it or not, and whether we're ready for it or not. It's simply a fact. So the prevailing notion is that we need to do whatever we can do to prepare them when they're in prison, when they're in jail, and prepare ourselves for them when they come out. So just a couple of facts and figures. 2,166,260 number of persons incarcerated in the United States. Virginia prisons, about a little over 30,000, and about 95% of those folks will be released. Some are serving life sentences, some are on death row, some will die in prison, but 95% of them will come out to our communities. In Alexandria Jail, the average monthly population is 400, and virtually 100% of those offenders will be released, because those are not the life sentences, not the death row inmates and so forth. Released annually from Virginia prisons, 13,000. Number of prisoners released in 2012 from Alexandria Jail, 4,887, with a daily average of 13. So they're coming out. Like I said, it's not optional. They're coming out whether we're ready for them or not, and whether they're ready or not. Recidivism is something we talk about a lot. Recidivism is the likelihood of reoffending. As you can see, the statistics are not that great. I can tell you that Virginia is actually a little bit better than that right now, and we're second in the country for lowest recidivism rate, so that's a great thing. But there's always opportunities to do better, and that's what my job is all about, and that's what reentry is all about, is maximizing the likelihood of success for these people so that they don't reoffend and don't victimize other people. So Governor McDonnell was very proactive in this respect, and it was part of his cornerstone of his public safety agenda was to bring reentry to the forefront. And so what he said was, preparing prisoners for successful reentry into communities is not soft on crime. It is sound public safety policy. It creates an opportunity to reduce recidivism and reflects the idea that America is a nation that believes in second chances. So this is what he believed, and this is what kind of set the pace for decisions he made in the future. So he announced that he was going to have a comprehensive prisoner reentry initiative for Virginia and issued an executive order that established the Virginia Prisoner and Juvenile Offender Reentry Council. And this brought together agencies, state agencies, faith-based, all kinds of different organizations and agencies who touched the lives of the offenders who were coming out from jail and prison, and brought them together to try to figure out what we could do to help these folks. And so he directed the Department of Corrections, who I work for, and the Juvenile Justice Department to come up with strategic plans in order to specifically address it, and conducted statewide outreach to promote local community engagement in reentry, because what we found is that this is not simply a criminal justice problem, and it just doesn't just have a criminal justice solution. It's everybody. Everybody has neighbors, friends, family members, people they know that have come in contact with the criminal justice system and that need help in order to avoid going back to prison or jail. So I'm going to talk a little bit about the Department of Corrections strategic plan, and it's called the Adult Reentry Initiative. And basically it just has the principle starts where the offender is sent to prison. We don't start talking about reentry 90 days out, 6 months out, whatever. It begins the day they step foot in prison and continues straight up through when probation ends, if they're put on probation. So everybody's assessed for what their needs are. Even when they're in prison, a case plan is developed so that they're getting the attention, they're getting needs met, things such as education, employment, cognitive behavioral programs are very popular, and substance abuse and those sorts of things. And so they're recommending programs even starting from then, and targeting the people who need it most, which are the medium and higher risk offenders. We find that people who are low risk offenders will probably do okay whether we do anything with them or not. They're probably not going to reoffend, the low risk offenders. So focusing our interventions on the higher and medium risk offenders. Evidence-based practice, everybody talks about evidence-based practice, and so we're all on board with that. Focusing on needs and making sure that everything is planned and arranged before they're released. Try to have graduated release, and this has been particularly newsworthy lately when they're talking about isolation and administrative segregation, and it's been making the news lately, and there's something to be said for this because there were, if you can believe it, people who would spend years in administrative segregation or isolation and then be moved right out into the community, and that is just a formula for disaster. So they're doing things now to kind of graduate their release so that they're not, those situations are very, very rare. And then collaboration is a key part, and we talked about that a lot already. But in the reentry world, it's critical. It really is critical. And that's not just criminal justice agencies, but community agencies, nonprofits, faith-based organizations. It's all very, it's essential. So what they've done is the Department of Corrections set up intensive reentry programs, which are programs in the prisons located at strategic locations around the state so that prisoners spend the last, say, year, 6 months to a year of their sentence in a location closer to where they're likely to be released. And so that makes it possible for their family members to visit, which is key in success. And it also it puts them in a situation where they can be in a setting that's more conducive for them to get the help that they need to prepare to get out. So they address a lot of different issues. They have workforce development. Probation officers go in there and talk about what it means to be successful on probation. Local community service providers come in to help them plan for when they get out. They have family reunification seminars where they come in and the families can come in and they can actually talk about rebuilding the family and how important they are to their success. And they have something called, they're placed in what's called a cognitive community setting, where 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, they are made to think about the decisions that they make, and they're called to task when they make poor choices and try to trade in that high risk and criminal thinking for more pro-social thoughts and values. And they find that that's really where the success lies. You can have a job, you can have a place to live, you can have food on the table, but if you're still stuck in criminal thinking, you're probably going to reoffend. So that's where a lot of the focus, attention's being focused now, is figuring out what to do to change criminal thinking. And this works in the mental, the population of the those with mental illness as well. It's a little more challenging, but... So what happens is that the transition is more prepared, it's seamless, and once they come out on probation, and we continue whatever it was they were doing in the prison, we continue it when they come out. And so we try to supervise them for success rather than trying to catch them doing bad things. So our intensive reentry program is located out near Culpeper at Coffeywood Correctional Center, and then the women's prison at Goochland. So those are the two. That's the closest, Coffeywood's the closest prison to here. There's not a lot of prisons around Northern Virginia, but that's the closest one to us. So, another feature of the initiative is a senior reentry probation officer who, what she does is she spends all her time either at Coffeywood or in the probation districts and trying to get those linkages so it is seamless. And ours is a, located at Coffeywood and services Alexandria and Fairfax County. And she does a whole variety of things that's designed to just make sure that they're prepared, that the offender's as best prepared as possible. And the last one you see down there is works with local reentry councils, and that's kind of what I'm going to talk about next are our reentry councils. And I'm going to kind of skip through this. The state set some guidelines for what they call reentry councils, and basically what the reentry councils are the groups of people getting together from the local communities and talking about the issues involved in reentry. And so the state kind of, they didn't require us to do it, but they strongly recommended that we do it. And so here in, let me skip through these, here in Alexandria, We established our reentry council in January of 2011. It's co-chaired by myself and Suzanne Chiss, who is the director of social services. We started off meeting every month. Now we meet every other month. And basically what we do is we talk about practices and policies that are interfering with our clients' ability to make a positive reintegration back into the community. And so we have a vision statement and a mission statement, and on your tables there are brochures, and all this information is pretty much in there, so just when you get a chance. But really, the vision is that all previously incarcerated individuals returning home to Alexandria will be supported by their community and provided opportunities to engage in services and pro-social activities that encourage healthy life choices and personal accountability, offering hope for their future. And then our mission is to seek to build a stronger and safer Alexandria by developing community partnerships, raising public awareness, and offering effective and integrated services to residents returning home from incarceration. So that's what our goals are. We have a lot of different organizations and agencies involved, DCHS, Sheriff's Office, Offender Aid and Restoration, all the shelters, Friends at Guest House, which is a women's residential program, if you're familiar with that in the city, the Housing Authority, KI Services provides medical services, Public Defender's Office, of course, Department of Corrections, Department of Juvenile Justice, and a host of churches and congregations and concerned citizens who give up their time, which is unbelievably beneficial to us and to our clients. Again, I talked already really about the goals, and just to get the stakeholders together, identify gaps, address issues. We have a case management work group, which is sort of a direct, provides direct client services. They're like a case management team, and they're trying to get jail inmates ready for release as well, and to heighten public awareness, which is a really big piece to this, is just making people aware that we exist and that there is a need out there. And so we have some work groups. Like I said, our integrated services committee is our case manager. We have mentoring, employment, family support, and we've got the Interfaith Reentry Collaborative, which we actually merged with Arlington on that piece of it. And then we had a workshop to kind of gain some focus, and out of the workshop, this was last September. Mayor was there, this was just us getting together and hashing out some strategies for targeting our focus. And so the top three focus areas that were identified, which any of us who work in this field know that the employment and housing are always going to rise to the top as far as areas, and then direct client services. So we created action plans and work groups, and so we've got some great things coming that we're working on, and a lot of really dedicated people. I wanted to show you some of the things that other communities were doing, either with the reentry council or not, but Charlottesville declared itself a city of second chances, which was pretty cool, and they had a resolution to that effect. Martinsville had a proclamation, Reentry Awareness Month, which was February of 2013. I don't know if they've done it again for February of 2014, but that was signed by the mayor. There are town hall meetings being held, like this one in Norfolk. Richmond City had a Reentry Awareness Week. Again, Richmond had a State of Reentry in our region. It was a community forum. Fairfax had a forum not too long ago, seminar. With a lot of people came to that. So, to kind of close up, there is actually also a federal reentry council, and they attempt to address the same issues at the federal level. And so, Eric Holder convened this a couple years ago, and what he said is that when reentry fails, the costs, both societal and economic, are high. Our joint commitment is to eliminate barriers to successful reentry by improving employment, housing, treatment, and educational opportunities for individuals who've been incarcerated so they can support themselves and their families and contribute to their communities. And that kind of sums up what we believe here and what we're trying to aspire to. So that's it. That's me. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for listening. And with that, I'll hand it over to Bill.
Yeah, I know. I wasn't as gifted as the rest in my gait. Thank you. It's my pleasure also to be here to talk about CORE, or the Collaboration for Recovery and Reentry. It's one of the many jail diversion initiatives here in the city of Alexandria, but it's the one that's closest to my heart. So, and it's a I think we've kind of, Lisa was talking about broader reentry issues. CORE is a very specific program that we started and developed here in the city. So I'll give you an idea of one very specific thing that we're doing, that similar to CIT. Well, similar in that it's very specific program. So CORE, in a nutshell, is a partnership between the Alexandria CSB, or the larger Department of Community and Human Services, and the Office of Probation and Parole, or State Probation, and the Alexandria Criminal Justice Services, or Local Probation. And it's aimed at helping offenders with mental illness live healthy and law-abiding lives in the community. For those of you who don't know, the difference between state probation and local probation is that state probation is primarily geared towards people who have committed serious crimes or felonies, and local probation is for lesser crimes or misdemeanors. So we got our start with CORE in 2009. We received some funding from the State Department of Behavioral Health and Developmental Services, that's it. And we decided, and the funding was to target initiatives for individuals with mental illness who found themselves caught up in the criminal justice system. And the goal was to help move people away from the criminal justice system into treatment. And we decided to focus our efforts at the end of that chart that Liz showed earlier, in Intercept 5, with community corrections. And you know, some might think, well, that's the end of the criminal justice system. But we find that it's really the beginning. People are coming back to the community, and we want to give them the best chance for success and partner with our community corrections partners. So a little bit about the local oversight of the program and the funding. There's the Alexandria Criminal Justice Board. This is a board that every jurisdiction in the Commonwealth of Virginia is required to have, just like a community services board. And in 2008, the CCJB Jail Diversion Subcommittee was created by Liz Wixon, and because she really saw it, you know, she supervises the jail mental health team and some of the outpatient services with the CSB, and was really in a unique position to see how people were cycling through both of them, and there really wasn't a lot of effort to help break up that cycle. And so with the creation of this subcommittee and the support of local stakeholders, and along with Liz's vision and leadership, it really positioned the city well for when funding opportunities became available to target this population, that we were able to take advantage of them. And that's what we did in the spring of 2009. So the CCJB Jail Diversion Subcommittee continues to meet quarterly and helps provide us with some direction. And it's made up of representation from the Commonwealth Attorney's Office, the Public Defender's Office, the police, the Sheriff's Office, both probation agencies, and representatives from the Department of Community and Human Services. And then the CORE coordinating meeting is a clinical meeting that's comprised of service providers for the purpose of really doing the work of coordinating care for the individuals who are enrolled in the program and to take a look at new referrals. And this meeting takes place every other week. So what exactly is CORE? We, you know, in order to develop the partnership between the CSB and the probation agencies, we decided that we needed a person at the CSB who could really help move the initiative forward. So we created a CORE and jail diversion coordinator position. The person who currently holds this position is Michelle Albert, who's a licensed professional counselor, and she provides intensive case management. She has enough flexibility in her schedule where she can provide rapid intakes to people. For instance, if somebody is unexpectedly released from jail, from court, and needs to, it didn't have everything in place to get referred to outpatient services, she can get involved and get the person connected immediately, as opposed to the person having to wait on a waiting list. She works very closely with the mental health probation officers at the probation agencies. I'll talk a little bit more about them in the next slide. And another interesting thing that Michelle does is she monitors the people who are being booked into the Alexandria Detention Center. And if somebody is active with the Community Services Board, is actively in treatment, Michelle will email the service provider, the service provider's supervisor, and alert the jail mental health team that the person's there. And what this does is it really primes communication right from the start and keeps communication fluid between the community service providers, the jail, and the people providing treatment in the jail. And when we talk about this across the state to other people who are in this business, they love this idea. So, and it really has helped us with maintaining linkages between the jail and the community. So the other side of CORE is we now have two mental health probation officers in the city, but we started with one at Alexandria Probation and Parole in 2009, and the person who currently holds that position is Kim Settle, and she is a licensed clinical social worker. And we're fortunate to have both the CORE and jail diversion coordinator and the mental health probation officer Kim Settle here in the audience. The premise of having a person located at the mental health, right? So we've got another mental health provider and we've got another probation officer. So what's the big deal about that? The idea is that the two of them both have similar caseloads, and they are dedicated to serving those individuals that are on their caseloads. And they talk daily about the people that they're providing services to. And the significance of this formalized relationship, as opposed to just a probation officer calling the mental health provider, is that if somebody comes to see Kim and says, "I lost my medication," Kim can pick up the phone, call Michelle, and the issue is resolved that day. If it's a regular old probation officer, he or she calls, might get a voicemail, leaves a message for a case manager who returns the call a day or two later. The probation officer's now moved on to something else. And before you know it, days or weeks have gone by before that issue is resolved. So the formalized relationship is really significant here. And what the mental health probation officer does is, obviously the caseload targets individuals with serious mental illness and co-occurring disorders. The probation officer has a smaller caseload of 40 individuals as compared to 70 to 100 of the average probation officer caseload. And this allows for the mental health probation officer to be much more involved and to partner with community partners, not just the mental health providers, but the police and the courts as well. And when I mentioned Kim and Michelle, I also added their credentials, that Michelle's a licensed professional counselor and Kim is a licensed social worker. They both have specialized training, not only in treating behavioral health disorders, but Lisa alluded to this, is that what really needs to happen with if we want to help change people's moving in and out of the criminal justice system is we also need to help them change the way they think, and we call that criminal thinking. And that really is some, you know, requires some specialized training. We've, across the country, communities have found that behavioral health treatment really is good at treating behavioral health disorders. People get better. But it doesn't necessarily mean that it's good at treating criminal justice problems. So we really need to treat both of those things. And that requires some specialized training. And we're fortunate to have both Kim and Michelle on our teams. And I skipped over the Alexandria Criminal Justice Service mental health probation officer. We were able to create that position last July, and we were able to do that through the support of our local stakeholders. We were able to leverage some of the state money that we received to get a little extra local money, and we're really excited about the expansion of the program. And CORE also includes, we were able to expand our psychiatric service by 2 hours a week, and we have a small pot of money that we call our Client Services Fund, which allows us to help people get specialized treatment and support when other resources aren't available. So we've been at this for about 5 years now. And I just want to share some of our successful outcome data with you. Whenever you talk to treatment providers about this population, you'll hear that more housing options are needed. And you know, I assume that most of you live in Alexandria. You know that affordable housing is really at a premium in the city, particularly when you're coming out of jail and you have literally no resources. And it can be really disheartening as a service provider to see people be challenged in such a way. But when we look at the data, we really find that we've done some good work. The charts here represent the housing situation for individuals at the time of enrollment. And then at discharge, we've reduced homelessness by 12%. We've increased the use of CSB residential services by 22%. And the largest thing that we've done is really helped people move into private residences. And I was thinking about this earlier today, and I think we don't really take notice of that, but what we do is people ultimately come back to the community and their family. And with the additional support and services, and a lot of times those connections are broken, but with the additional support and services that we provide, it really allows for families to give clients another chance and allow them back into the home and to be successful with their family. We're talking a lot about behavioral health care, and insurance is the way to healthcare in this country. If you don't have it, you have a tough time getting healthcare. So the primary insurance that the people that we serve have is Medicare and Medicaid. And what, again, the charts represent enrollment and discharge, and we've been able to increase the percentage of those receiving Medicaid by 32%. Unfortunately, at the time of discharge, another 33% of individuals remained uninsured. But we're hopeful, as there's more healthcare options that are coming down the pike that we will be able to have an even greater impact here. And SSI and SSDI, these are Social Security disability programs, and you know, we're talking about people with serious behavioral health disorders that are disabling in all aspects of their life. And so they are disabled, and a large percentage of them, their primary income is Social Security programs. And so we were able to help increase the amount of people receiving Social Security benefits by 25%. And anyone who's dealt with Social Security knows that sometimes they move a little slow. So after 1 year, we still had another 19% who were waiting eligibility determination, but we were hopeful that they would eventually get the benefits. And finally, you know, we're talking about people cycling in and out of the criminal justice system or jail primarily. And what we looked at is the amount of time that individuals spent in jail prior to being involved with the CORE program, and then the amount of time they spent in jail the year after they were involved in the CORE program. And what we found was they spent 77% less days in jail post our involvement. And we know that there's a lot of variables that impact individuals' lives, but we like to think that we had a little something to do with impacting that number. And you know, and we're really very proud of what we created with the CORE program. And you know, Lisa mentioned the Governor's Reentry Council from a couple years ago, and part of the Reentry Council did recommend that the CORE program be replicated throughout the state. So we're very proud of that fact too, and that's a little one of the programs that we have here in Alexandria. So thank you.
If you have questions, put it on one of these little bright colored square pieces of paper, and we'll take it and we'll ask your question. We're going to go ahead and get started while our board members are finishing collecting questions. We may not have time to ask all of these. Okay, first question. Do people with mental illnesses receive stiffer sentences for the same offenses? If so, why? Liz?
Yes. Is that on?
And why? Why do they?
I think it's a combination of factors, not the least of which is that you heard a lot of data tonight, is that people with behavioral health disorders often come to the attention of the criminal justice system more often. For example, think of someone on King Street who may be bothersome storefront owner or to the community. The police may get called to that sort of person more often than they may get called to people, right? So people tend to accrue more charges over time, and that in and of itself is something that a judge needs to consider when issuing a sentence.
Okay, thank you.
If I could add, what also happens is if somebody is symptomatic of like schizophrenia, and they're hearing voices or seeing things that aren't there, when they get to jail, they tend to be disruptive too. And they really need to be in the psychiatric hospital where they can get medication and care, but they're in jail. And they disrupt the jail, and then they refuse to go to court. And then they might assault one of the deputies in the jail. And then they have another charge. And so it might take that person a week or a month before they get to court. Meanwhile, the person who was just disorderly was released the next morning. So that's the same charge, for the person with the serious mental illness results in a month of incarceration, as opposed to the individual who just went to court the next morning and paid their fee. So that's how people get, and it's costly for the jail, because the jail has to manage, you know, has to put a lot of staff and to help manage the person's behavior, and then we have to try to help the person get medications, and medications are costly to the jail because people don't have health insurance in jail either. So.
All right, next question is for Sergeant Ballantyne. Why not do CIT in academy as well?
That's a great question. Not just from our agency, but a lot of times we don't want to teach officers the CIT skill set too early in their career, because we want them to really become police officers. I believe it's going on and off. They need to be able to find where they're going in the city, instead of focusing on some of the specific stuff that we talk about during the CIT program. And we also found that it's a great opportunity to bring the 10-year veteran back into their training program to remind them why they got into police work. It brings them back to where the beginning, and remind them that everybody's human.
We're having a lot of veteran issues, I think, these days, and we have a question about veterans. When a veteran who is being treated by the VA becomes incarcerated, that veteran loses access to and continuity of care from the VA. It is optional whether or not the VA even shares diagnostic information, prescriptions, or medical records. What issues do you encounter in providing for the medical, including mental health needs of veterans? What would you like to see the VA do to help incarcerated veterans? Anyone want to take that?
I will take a stab, but I'm going to forget many of the parts of that question. I will start by saying at DCHS, we, in the last few years, got very prepared for men and women returning from war. We were ready, right? There's been a lot of talk. You've heard a lot. You might have heard of the Wounded Warrior Association. There's a lot of activity in the country about being prepared and ready to treat people who need treatment. And we trained up, we amped up, and it did not come. We really don't see very many veterans in the city. That's the first point. Second, it is true though that that we do see some veterans in our jail, and I can think of a couple of cases in the last 5 or 6 years of someone who was arrested for a symptom related to his post-traumatic stress disorder. And in both cases that I'm thinking of, the public defender's office was very, very active with the treatment staff in the jail in contacting the VA and arranging for a transfer of the person when the charges were null pros. Into the VA system, into a VA hospital. That was what the level of care that both of these people needed. We can, and we do, share information with the VA whenever a client will allow us to do that. We need to have someone's permission to be talking with their with other people about their health care, their mental health care. And we ask for that all the time, because coordinating care is the foundation of what we need to do to be successful. If we don't try to see ourselves in isolation, We fail miserably, frankly, when we forget that. In terms of healthcare, I will say, you know, the detention center has not only a mental health and substance abuse treatment staff in the detention center, but 24-hour medical care. The sheriff's office has a contract with a medical provider who has nurses around the clock and physician and nursing assistant care in the detention center who the behavioral health staff work with very, very closely. So people who need care get that level of care in the jail, and frankly, particularly with Sheriff Lawhorn, is very, very committed to making sure that people get the care that they need, and I think that works really quite well.
All right. Now, here's a question I think that a lot of us would wonder about. What do you look for to identify mental illness on an initial police intervention in an accident?
I just want to confirm, a traffic accident?
It just says an accident.
Well,
Make it incident.
Sure. That's a great question because what we, and I answer, I think, kind of incidents, apparently. So officers are trained to talk to people, listen to what's being told to them, but they're also watching body movement, they're watching what the person's not only saying with the words, but with their body. And sometimes that's called looking at the bigger picture, or the I call it looking at the painting. You know, we always look at everything, and we have to ask ourselves what's really going on, because there's always going to be, I guess, what we like to call in detective land, there's, you know, what I know, what they know, and then what really happened. And we look at what they're saying. Does it match with what has happened? When we go to calls for service, we look for clues around the house, medication bottles. We look to make sure that the house has been taken care of, there's not food sitting out, the pets are being taken care of. We're taking all that in to help determine if the person is taking care of themselves or is a danger to themselves. And in when regards to a traffic accident or anything, if that was the question, same thing. We're you know, we ask a lot of questions to determine if they know what day it is, where they are, where were they going, and those kinds of questions to help determine if they're within their right mind.
Okay, next question. What do you do with mental health patients who refuse treatment?
Well, it's a challenge. First, we try to engage them in treatment, and we're really pretty successful at that. But sometimes when somebody's not in the same state of reality that we are, or, you know, doesn't, you know, with schizophrenia in particular, sometimes people don't see that they're sick, even though everyone else can. And then we have a civil commitment process, which is known as the temporary detention order or emergency custody order. And we have the same process in the jail. The jail can't force people into treatment either. So if somebody's in the jail and they need to be hospitalized, there's a legal process for that to happen.
I think this question is related. What role is played by the medical community? Do you all interact with the medical community?
We do very much, and it plays a huge role. People are, you know, there's a whole body. The head is a piece of that body, and then there's everything else. And it's very, very important that mental health providers, therapists, and psychiatrists are aware of what else is going on with that person, and vice versa. So it's one of the first things we ask people when they come into our system is who's your primary care physician if you have one? What are your medical problems if you have any? We at the Alexandria CSB entered into a relationship a few years ago with ANSI, the Arlandria Neighborhood Health Services folks, the federally qualified health center in Arlandria that provides primary health care and some specialty health care to people who are uninsured or underinsured. And we entered into this relationship through a grant that now provides for a physician, a primary care doctor, a nurse, a medical assistant, and a researcher to be on site at the mental health center over on ASAP Street 2 days a week. And that is tremendous because so many of the clients that we serve in the mental health community don't have what we call a primary health home, right? They don't know, they don't have easy access to physicians if they do at all. And for them, it's yet another stop. I have to go see my psychiatrist, I have to go pick up my medicine, I have to go see my cardiologist. And to have all of that in one building, has we have seen, we really have seen people's lives saved by that relationship between the mental health staff and the primary care staff. It's so successful that we have a 3-month waiting list for clients to be seen by that primary care physician. Those folks are booked all day, every day that they're with us. If we had them 5 days a week, I think we would still have a waiting list. It's not to be underestimated, the relationship between primary health and behavioral health.
I think that you all may have answered this in your presentations, but we have a question here. Are prisoners with mental illness given their meds while in jail or in prison? I think the answer is yes.
Yes.
Okay, all right. How are mental illness and substance abuse related? Is there a lot of co-occurrence?
There is more than there is not. Most people, in fact, who have a mental illness also have a co-occurring substance use disorder. That is the norm. It's not the exception.
Okay. We have a question here. What can we do to have an Alexandria Reentry Summit, an Alexandria Reentry Summit.
Dedicated volunteers.
Okay.
No, I mean, that's something that we certainly need.
Can you hear me? Yeah? Okay. I mean, that's something that we definitely, you know, would like to do. It's, you know, we are trying to... We've had a little bit of trouble gaining some traction, and so what we did, you know, back in September with this workshop was try to gain focus. And public awareness is huge. Public awareness, community awareness is a critical piece to the Reentry Council, and I think a summit would, you know, certainly help us reach that goal of getting the word out to the community. So. It's certainly something that we talk about. Other places have done it. And anytime you're ready, Mr.
Okay, here's a very practical question. How do we ensure that individuals with mental health issues are released from incarceration with adequate supplies of medication to carry them through until they can get a new prescription?
The Department of Corrections does a much better job than they used to, I have to say, in identifying these people and making sure that they are have what they need when they're released. So typically what happens is shortly before the release, we get once they've identified where they're going home, so say they're coming home to Alexandria, they will make an appointment with the CSB well before they're released, so that within a day or two of their release, they'll have an appointment to meet with somebody at the CSB. In the meantime, they send prescriptions. I actually get in the mail, I get prescriptions that I give to their probation officer to make sure that they have their prescriptions, and they're released with a certain, and Kim back there may be able to help me with this, but they're released typically with a supply of medication. So the system is much better than it used to be. It used to be a real problem, but with the new reentry and the new emphasis on preparation, it just doesn't happen the way it used to happen. It's far better.
Okay, here is another. It says, may we have online access to the PowerPoint, and does Alexandria have special drug or other courts?
Yes, you may. We do not right now have specialty courts, a mental health court or a drug court. The closest thing we have to that is something you heard me make a brief mention of earlier through the public defender's office, these sentencing alternative plans. And those are their treatment plans created by staff at the public defender's office. It's a piece of paper that lists options for the judge to say John Doe has major depression and a co-occurring cocaine dependence, and these are the things that we think could help him address the symptoms for which he's now being sentenced. And the judge can can consider this plan. The judge can sentence the person to jail time or prison time, or can consider this plan. That is the spirit in some ways of what a mental health court is or a drug court. It's thinking a little differently about how to get people the help that they need rather than simply incarcerating them somewhere. It is getting them somewhere where the judge feels comfortable that he or she may get their needs met, and also is, of course, taking public safety into account. But we don't have a traditional mental health or drug court. That looks like there's a special docket, right? So and it requires a judge to sort of champion it. And communities that have implemented these things around the country have a judge who may have a particular interest in the topic, who may dedicate one day a week or one day every other week with a special docket. So when I say that, I mean everybody that the judge sees that day or that half a day is in drug court or in mental health court. It's not, you know, there's not a traffic violation and then someone who's in a drug court client.
Okay, this question, are citizens able to get the training that police get at a cost? Now, we've been hearing about the mental health first aid program. Can you all go into, well, this question, but perhaps also that?
No, nor, frankly, would CIT be appropriate for a citizen, but mental health first aid absolutely would be, and I don't know if my colleague Carol Ayer can speak to that, but it's a program that DCHS staff started providing a couple years ago, 2 years ago. It's a 12-hour.
It's now an 8-hour course we offer over two days, and you can look on the Department of Community and Human Services website.
How many people did not hear what she said? Okay. Okay. So it's an 8-hour course. That's good. Give her good. Great. Perfect.
Mental health first aid is now an 8-hour course that's provided over 2 days. So it's 4 hours over each of 2 days. And if you're interested in registering for that, you can go on to our Department of Community and Human Services website through the city's website, looking under departments, and there are links that will allow you to register for some upcoming sessions of that. We have an adult 8-hour course and then a separate youth 8-hour course. They're two different ones. That's what's offered through the city. It is, yes.
And he said it's free. It's free.
And it's really helpful. I don't know anyone who has taken it who has not walked away feeling that it's been some of the best time that they've spent. It's really terrific. And I encourage if you have any interest in it to please get on the website and sign up.
Yeah, we have had very good responses from everybody just about who's taken that course. Though it is probably less intensive and detailed and targeted than the first responders training, the CIT training.
Okay, could you give an example of changing criminal thinking? Is there some, a personal example of some kind? We heard a couple of you mention that.
Well, there's some risk factors involved with criminal behavior and criminal thinking. I guess would be just thought about taking. Well, direction is one. It is sometimes if somebody's boss, your boss tells you to perform a task and says it in a stern way, Most of us would just kind of say, all right, I'm just going to go do it. But if you're in the mindset of criminal thinking, you're going to think, who the hell is this guy to tell me what to do? and then you get oppositional about performing the task. And you can't be thinking that way if you expect to keep your job for very long. So that's one simple example of how you need to help people change the way they think about their personal interactions with other people.
Something to think about. The very skills and tools that someone needs to be successful in the jail, right? Maybe being paranoid, maybe making sure you're in a safe environment. Those might be very helpful in jail. They are not very helpful on the street. So if you think about, and Lisa talked about people being in admin seg or in isolation, it's the same sort of thing. If you are locked away for a year or 5 or 10 years, and you've not been given opportunities to think differently, you've not been given opportunities for treatment, and then you're released onto the street, ay, 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 that really is a recipe for disaster, and it's no wonder we see the recidivism rates that we see and people get reincarcerated, which is why we're doing all the things that we're trying to do is to really stop that pattern.
Okay, how are ex-offenders chosen for CORE? Or do they just sort of all go into it?
Well, they have to have be an Alexandria resident, have a serious mental illness or co-occurring substance abuse disorder, and they have to be on state or local probation.
Okay. I think we have a lot of questions that we couldn't ask, and thank every one of you. We probably have more questions tonight than we've had in a long time. But before I give up the microphone, I would like to recognize two groups that are here who are volunteers who have really served this community for many years. One is Friends of the Alexandria Mental Health Center, and the other is the Anti-Stigma Hope Campaign of the Partnership for a Healthier Alexandria. So anyway, they deserve a lot of our thanks.
Well, this program, can you hear me? Okay. This program is really what Agenda Alexandria is all about. After every program, people come up to me and say, well, I didn't know that about the torpedo factory, or I never really understood transportation planning before. For me, this is that program. I don't think there's been a program that I knew as little about, or a subject I knew as little about coming into the program as this one. And I have to say, obviously, this is probably the program I learned the most from. So I'd like to say thank you very much to Bill, Roslyn, Tim, for putting it together. And I'd like to say a very warm thank you to our panelists, Liz, Sergeant Ballantyne, Lisa, and Bill, for delivering a terrific program. Let's give them a hand. Okay, I see Alan's got it up for us for next month. I hope to see many, if not all of you, back here next month, March 24th, Monday, for our emergency, Are We Prepared? Good evening, and thanks for coming.